next topic that we are going to see in this research is communication and research utilization. Okay, so the communication of research findings is very important. Okay, what is the point of doing research if you cannot use it and communicate it to the general public, the medical fraternity and other people? Okay, so communication of research finding is very, very important. So in this chapter, we'll just see the purpose of communication of research findings. Then we'll see the methods, like the verbal reports that you can do, and then a scientific report. And finally, we'll conclude by seeing how the research findings that you have done in your research can be utilized. Okay, that is utilization of research findings. Okay, so let us see the purpose of communicating research findings. You are doing research, and in fact, in the whole world, a lot of medical professionals, right from doctors, nurses, paramedical workers, everybody does research in their own field, or sometimes in multidisciplinary fields, that is two fields together, a nursing and a medical aspect, or a medical sociology and a physiotherapy aspect. So mix of different professions. So ultimately, the main reason for doing research is so that the patient will benefit, or the care will be better for patients. Okay, research is not only done in the medical field, but it was also done in educational field, it is done in automobile factories. So everywhere and anywhere research is done. So once you do a research, you cannot just finish the research and keep it in your own computer or in your own mind. Okay, why you did research is to find something new, or to validate what is already being done. Okay, if somebody is treating cough with the cough syrup, then either you do a research to find effectiveness of a new cough syrup, or you validate the effectiveness of the cough syrup that is being used already. Okay, so these are different types of research. So once you have finished the research, you have to tell the other people that the existing cough syrup is good and it will help in curing the cough. Or you can say it is not good, you have to find a new cough syrup. Or if you have used a new cough syrup in place of the old one, then you will say my cough syrup is better than the previous cough syrup. Okay, so these are different research findings, and you have to communicate it so that the patient will benefit and the other medical professionals will use your research in their own medical practice. This is called evidence-based practice. So this evidence-based practice is a very important word that you have to understand. Okay, so research is usually done by the investigator, and they find one particular solution, or they find a particular phenomena as part of the research, and this result of the research has to be communicated. Okay, if you communicate, then it will help in dissipation of the knowledge. Okay, knowledge is something that you have to spread. Why do teachers teach in school and college? So that the knowledge that they have is passed on to the students. If the teacher thinks that my knowledge is only mine, personal, then the students will not learn. Okay, the dissipation of knowledge, what you have learned through your research, has to be made public so that everybody knows the importance of your research and the results of your research. Then it is also used as broadcasting of generalizations, so that its maximum use is done. Okay, once your research is complete, you have to publish the research so that it is maximally utilized by many people. Okay, so one of the main reasons for research is to inform, to propagate knowledge. Propagate knowledge means to spread the knowledge that one person has got through the research to the other people. Okay, so all those people who are interested in knowing about your particular research. Okay, these days the Google search and other search engines are very effective in spreading the research reports. So one person just has to type the keyword and they get all the information relating to that particular topic or research. Okay, so anybody who's interested in that particular topic will know your results and will understand the findings of your study through your research publication, which is available on the internet or on research journals. And mainly the research journals will keep keywords which help people to search for the research results. Okay, so mainly the knowledge dissipation, spread of knowledge, is one of the most important outcomes and purpose of communicating the research finding. Okay, usually how do you communicate the research finding is through a research report. Okay, we'll be seeing in the later next topic about verbal report and scientific report. So these are some of the ways in which we can inform the public. You can inform your teachers, and if you're a student, you can inform your teachers and coordinators or your guide through a verbal report. If you want to publicize it and make it widely available, then you have to write a scientific report. This will help in spreading the research findings. Okay, so reporting just means that you are spreading the information that you got through your research through your report. Okay, as part of your research, you will have facts and figures, that is data which is collected. You would have analyzed the data and you have come to conclusion. Okay, when you publicize the data, other people can corroborate or say yes, what you have done is correct, or some people may find fault in the way you have done research. Okay, so all this, and if they are not finding fault to say that you have made a mistake, but when the next person does a similar kind of research, they will ensure that they do not make the same mistake. So these are the reasons why the research findings have to be communicated. Okay, when you communicate through reports, all the information, that is the literature study that you have done, your discussion and your results and your conclusions, everything has to be compiled in a simple, understandable form, and then it has to be published. Okay, so when you do a research report, it is not a complete description of what you have done. Okay, some relevant important aspects of your research you can publish. See, if you would have done your research for 1 year, some studies or some researches are done for many years in many hospitals. If every aspect of the research has to be written down, then it will take years to publish and it will become a big book which people will not read. So instead, what research you have done should be written up or reported in a simple, understandable format. The format and the components of your research report are all discussed in later part of this topic. Okay, so when we discuss about scientific report, we will see each part of the report that you have to write. Okay, so I hope you understood the purpose of communicating the research finding. So let us see the two methods of there are other methods as well, which we will see in the next chapter. In this chapter, as per your syllabus, we have the verbal report and the scientific report. So first we'll see what is the verbal report. Okay, verbal, nothing means, it means nothing but oral report or a talking form. Okay, it's not a written form, but you report it through your mouth by telling it out. Okay, so reporting verbally is usually done in conferences or seminars or to your superiors, or if you're a student, your teachers or your guides who have guided you in the research, you will report orally about what you have done in your research. Okay, but much more important is the report in scientific workshops, conferences and seminars. People travel to different parts of the world and the country to report about their research findings, so that other people in other parts of the world who work in similar settings or similar patients can use your research in their own work. Okay, so that is why oral reports are very important. So if you are presenting in a conference, then you can use only oral report, or you can have a PowerPoint presentation, or you can have a poster presentation to supplement your presentation. Okay, so most of the scientific conferences have oral presentations. So you will have to present whatever research you have done and your research findings in an understandable format to the people who are attending the research conference. Okay, so this will help the people who are attending the research conference to learn about the latest in the field. You will be presenting research findings which are also latest in the field. You are not going to study about something which happened 50 years back unless it has some relevance in the present day scenario. Okay, for example, people are studying about Spanish flu which happened 100 years back so that they can compare it with the coronavirus pandemic. So something like that is effective, but something which is dead and gone 50 years back you cannot use for your research unless it is something current which will help the people in their work. Okay, so when you do oral or verbal report, it provides an opportunity for you to get your feedback. You know, you have done research in a particular way, so other people who are working in the similar field will help you to understand whether what you have done is right or whether you could have modified or done it in a better way. And you usually the conferences will have a question answer sessions at the end of the conference where they will have doubts which they can ask you and you will be able to answer. Okay, so usually conferences when they are organized, they send out letters to people in similar organizations asking them if they want to present papers, and if you are interested to give a oral report, then you can participate in the research conference and say that you have a particular abstract or a topic of which you will do research presentation, and then they will go through your abstract and accept or reject it. If you are accepted, then you will have to participate in the research and present your oral report or a verbal report. So usually the sections of the presentation, okay, the parts which are presented by you in the as part of the verbal report is your own wish, because it's a verbal report. You can decide what you want to present or what you do not want to present. Usually if you are publishing in a journal, they have a prescribed format, but in a research presentation or verbal presentation, you can omit certain things and tell out what you think is important for the people who are listening to you. Okay, but at the same time you will have to get approval from the sponsors of the research or the organizers of the research, and they will have certain procedure or format that they have which you have to follow. Okay, usually there will be an introduction, then the description of methods, presentation of the results, and then you will discuss the findings and you will have a PowerPoint presentation which you can show in the conference. Okay, so if you have to make your verbal report very effective, then there are some things that you have to understand. You have to be organized in your thought and your talk. You have to decide what you want to tell. You cannot just go there and read from your paper. You have to have clarity in your mind on what you want to present there, and you can use your notes or you can use PowerPoints and other visual aids. And then when you talk, you have to be relaxed and make eye contact with all the people present there. Speak in a slow and understandable manner, and then make sure that it is in simple language so that everybody understands what your research was about. Okay, if you are doing a poster presentation, then it should have relevant information. You cannot crowd a poster with a lot of information, but have enough information which is very relevant and have good conclusions and results for your poster presentation. That will help more people to understand about your research. Okay, so the next topic that we are going to see is the scientific report. See, scientific report is a very important report that you will have to publish. So usually a scientific report is done for a exam, like a thesis presentation for your master's degree or for a final year project, undergraduate course, or a PhD thesis. So these are the times when you usually do a scientific report. Other than this, when you publish your paper, when you publish your research, then you do a scientific report. Okay, so each of these scientific reports emphasize or place importance on certain things. Okay, the first thing is the methodology that you used. You have to use the right kind of methodology. Your objectives of the study should be proper. Okay, objectives are should be smart. They should be specific, measurable, achievable. Okay, have a specific timeline. So all these aspects should be present in the objectives. Then your assumptions or your hypothesis is very important. So it will be having a lot of scrutiny whether you have made the right assumptions, whether you had the right hypothesis. So all that is a very important part of your scientific report. And then the place from which you collect data and how you analyze data is also very important, because any scientific report or publication, the data collection methods will undergo a lot of scrutiny. You have to have correct methods, proper methods. We already studied about the methods of data collection, which is valid, which is reliable. So you should have a valid method and a reliable method of data collection and a good analysis. The software which you used, the method you used, all that are important. Okay, finally, based on all this, you will provide findings or your results and then conclusion. Okay, sometimes you may have had some limitations during your research, that also has to be presented. So all this form important aspects of any scientific report. So now we'll see each part of a scientific report. Okay, the report, usually when you do a paper publication or when you do a thesis, it has all these aspects. The first part is your title. The title should be very brief. It should be short, specific, and informative. Okay, so the title itself should tell about the purpose and scope of your study. So you cannot have a title which is two lines or three lines. It should be a few words. Okay, only the important words should be in your title. Okay, but at the same time, it should tell the relevant information on what research you are doing. For example, measurement of knowledge of nurses about self-care in leprosy. Okay, this is a short and sweet title which tells what you are planning to do in a research. Okay, if you have a long title, you can say measurement of the knowledge of nurses working in Shefflin Institute of Health Research in Leprosy Center about the self-care of the hands, self-care of the eyes, self-care of the legs, and how the patient is performing in leprosy. Okay, which is a very large title which has a lot of information, but they're not too relevant. Okay, when you say self-care and leprosy, it means it includes the eyes, hands, and the feet, and also other aspects of leprosy, and you're testing the knowledge of nurses. Okay, so in your detailed report, you can say about where the nurses are located and all that. In your title, just measurement of knowledge of nurses about self-care and leprosy would be enough. Okay, the next thing is the abstract. When you publish or when you do any research, after you complete it, you also have to make an abstract, which is a short and simple one paragraph or maximum 400 words or two. Some people restricted to 250 words, some people to 500 words. So abstract should be about 250 words to 500 words, probably one or two paragraphs, but it should include various aspects like methodology, introduction, and conclusion, and results, findings, and all this. So in one or two lines, you have to write about each of these aspects, and that will be, if anybody wants to just have a brief idea about your research, they can just go through the abstract, and if they are interested, then they will go on to read much more about the research. So that is why abstract is very, very important. Then comes the introduction. We have already discussed about introduction, literature review in your classes earlier. So introduction tells about the background of your study, why you are doing a particular research, what context you are doing your research, and it will also tell the reader about what your research is all about? Which topic you have selected for your research? What you are planning to do in your research? And why you are doing this particular research? Why other people have not done? Or what is unique about your research? All this will be in the introduction. The next part is the literature review. Literature review is a survey of all the relevant research in the particular field. For example, if our topic is measurement of knowledge of nurses about self-care and leprosy, we will be doing a literature review on the knowledge of nurses, measurement of knowledge of nurses in other topics as well, not only in leprosy but other areas, so that we will see how they have done their studies. And then we will do literature review about self-care in leprosy, and then we will merge both and see if there's any research on measurement of knowledge of nurses in self-care in leprosy. So all the previous researches and how they have done will be collated, and the relevant information can be used. And you can also say in the literature review how you are going to be differing in your study from the ones that have already been done, from the research that has already been done in the past. Okay, so that makes your research unique. Okay, the next part is the methodology. Okay, methodology is the method or the materials and the methods that you are going to use in your research. So the methodology is very important, how you are going to do the research. So this is where your research design and other aspects, the sample size, all that comes into play. We have already studied about sample size, research designs, research method. So all that is part of the methodology, how you are going to do the study. Okay, what are the subjects or your samples, how you are selecting the samples, what equipments are you using, what method of data collection are you using, are you using questionnaire, why you are using questionnaire. If you are doing multiple methods, like if you are using a questionnaire, then you are doing an interview, then what are the relevant things you are doing, which place you are doing the research, which institution is you are doing. So inclusion criteria of samples, exclusion criteria of samples, all this will come in the methodology. Okay, once you have discussed or written about the methodology, finally the results will have information. Okay, the result is what you have, what data you have collected and analyzed, that will come in your result. So you would have collected a lot of data, you would have be put them in the tabular column, whatever is important. All the data need not be there in the scientific report. What is relevant for the reader should be there in a proper understandable manner. And then you have to present your results in tabular form or chart form or a graphical form. Okay, then there comes the discussion part. So whatever you have found in your results, that you will discuss, and you will tell how your hypothesis or assumptions that you made at the beginning of the study have been corroborated, or it has been supported by your research finding, or how it is contrary to previous research done by other people, or how it supports previous research done by other people. So here you can compare some aspects what you have discussed in the literature review, you can compare with your study in the discussion also. And main focus will be on your results and how you found the results, what are the findings that you have done, and why it is very important for the field of medicine or for patient care. So all that you will do in the discussion. Finally, you will give the conclusion. Conclusion will be a little short. Based on your discussion, you will conclude why your study is important, how it is applicable in the various other aspects of medical field. So that will be the conclusion. Okay, and then the last topic of this chapter is utilization of findings. See, once you have done your research, you would have found some aspects which form your conclusion. Okay, so many people do research day in and day out. There are hundreds of people doing research and they have research findings. So they have conclusions from which the research findings are presented. Okay, so how do we use these findings? How does the general public use the findings? How does the medical people use the findings? Okay, how does the government use the findings? If research, see, if I'll give you a simple example. Coronavirus, we know that it can be prevented if you wear masks, if you wash your hands, and if you sanitize your hands and social distance is maintained. How did people know that coronavirus can be prevented by wearing masks, social distancing and sanitizing your hands? Because of research. They did research when it first attacked China and other countries. The research was done. And so they published the results. And based on that result, the government made a policy so that all the public and other people should wear masks, have social distancing, and they should also clean their, wash their hands or sanitize their hands at regular intervals. So based on some research, the government made a policy regarding prevention of coronavirus and avoiding coronavirus. See how one research has helped in changing the policy over the whole world. So this is how different kinds of research will help in formulating improved health policy across the world. I have just given one example. It is applicable in various fields, in the treatment of leprosy, in the treatment of cancer, prevention of cancer, cure of cancer, all these aspects. Okay. Then other than this, in the clinical setting or in the hospital or in the wards, how does research help? It helps, it promotes critical thinking. People are able to think critically and they find out which why particular thing happens. If a person has severe breathing difficulty because of wheezing, then they think, why does wheezing cause breathing difficulty? Has this person been exposed to dust? Has this person been exposed to other pollutants? So that kind of thinking comes when they see a patient suffering. So in other aspects as well. Okay, so that promotion of critical thinking is coming because of the research utilization. Then it enhances professional self-concept. So any professional should have research. That is why your undergraduate degree has research as a major component. You have to publish a research dissertation. So that will help you to understand your self-concept about research. And every research makes healthcare into a safe and reflective practice. Okay, it does not make healthcare worse, it makes healthcare better, it makes it safe both for the healthcare worker and for the patient. Okay, because of the early research that was done on coronavirus, now people working in the health field are using PPE or personal protective equipment, and all the others in the sanitary field, everybody who comes across coronavirus patients use PPE. That is because of safe and reflective practice which came about from early research done on coronavirus. Okay, similarly, the practice based on current scientific sound knowledge. Okay, what is practice? Practice is nothing but working in the field, working in the hospital. So based on the knowledge, current knowledge or scientific knowledge which is published through research, people base their work based on the research. Okay, all the work that is going on in hospitals is based on research. If you are giving hydrochloroquine for coronavirus, that is based on research. If you are not giving hydrochloroquine for coronavirus, that is also based on research. Or if you are giving a particular dose of hydrochloroquine, that is also based on research, because somebody is already published saying this will help to kill the virus, or it is a prophylactic drug against the virus. So every practice or every activity, clinical activity that a healthcare worker does is based on scientific knowledge which is part of the research finding. Okay, and when people do research, especially healthcare workers do research, they get a lot of self-confidence in their own practice, in their work. They are sure that a patient will get treated and will become better because they have done research. Okay, so all this is called evidence-based practice. So evidence means proof and practice means work. So you are doing your medical work based on proof. Okay, can a policeman come and arrest you saying that you are a murderer without proof? No. Every arrest, every police investigation is to find proof, to find evidence against a thief or a murderer or anybody. Same way, a healthcare worker should treat patients only based on evidence. Okay, if you are giving ventilator care for a patient, you need evidence why that patient needs ventilator care. Okay, so we have studied in medical sociology 1 about patients taking the doctor to the court, consumer court. So if you practice, if you give fake medicines to a patient without evidence, thinking it will cure the patient can take you to the court. So that is why evidence-based practice is very important, and we utilize the research findings for evidence-based practice. The other areas in which we can use the research findings is to lower the cost of care. Okay, if there are two medicines, one is 500 rupees, another is 5 rupees, both of them have the same effect in curing a patient, you can use the 5 rupee medicine. Okay, because it has the same effect. So how do you find whether it has the same effect? By doing research. Okay, so you lower the cost of care, but at the same time you provide high quality care. See, there are so many equipments. We see that the ventilator costed so many lakhs, but now because coronavirus, a lot of people need ventilator care. A lot of scientists and researchers have been able to find newer versions of ventilators which cost as little as 20,000 rupees. So we are saving lakhs of money, but at the same time it provides the same high quality care which is provided by a better equipment or a costly equipment. Okay, so all these aspects of high quality care, cost effective care is based on research. Okay, so when you do cost effective care and high quality care based on research, you will improve the patient outcome or the client outcome. That is, patient will get better, they will get treated quickly, they will get treated with less cost, and they will be able to go back to their normal lifestyle in a easier and quicker time. Okay, and research can also be used for professionals for retention and for recruitment tool. So it can be used as a method of retaining people by using identifying their knowledge. So CMC has a policy where they give promotion based on research. So like that, retention and recruitment tool, also research can be used. And when research is done by staff, they will be professionally satisfied and they will be stimulated. So research means more knowledge. So when a person is keeping in touch with their subject, when they are constantly reading and doing research, their knowledge will be updated and they will be professionally satisfied. They will be stimulated to do more work, better work, and all these are important reasons how we can utilize the research findings and how we can improve the research. Okay, I hope you understood these areas of research. With this, we finish this chapter. We'll go on to the other next chapter later in the next class, which is significance of report writing and the steps in writing a report and the other types of reports, which we will see in the next class. Thank you.